The latest neuroscience experiments into cognition and perception point the way towards delightful and compelling new directions for our virtual worlds to take us. From David Byrne's VR immersive theater to the philosophical questions in Cory Doctorow's near future novel. Hi, I'm Crystal Beasley, and this is Embodied Reality. La, la, la. But let's start with the cutting edge of VR, AR, and MR that is already starting to make use of the entire body as the controller. The crushing tide has been towards more and more interaction. Films and TV passively broadcast but have no interactivity. Traditional gaming consoles like Xbox and PlayStation add interaction via buttons. VR opens up the possibility of involving the whole body as the controller. Bam. I'm hearing quiet little rumblings starting to appear. You're gonna think I'm off my oats, but the latest research in neuroscience backs me up. You can design your experience to create targeted emotional states. Say you want to make a game where people are trusting and cooperative. Your choice of gesture, body positions, and motions that you have your players use can induce trust and cooperation. If you want euphoria and competitiveness, you use a different set of gestures.
Fireball, recognize! Fourth ball, recognize!
Go forward, we have to go back. Way back. For 2,500 years, philosophers starting with Descartes conceived of the body and the brain as separate.
Cogito ergo sum.
I think, therefore I am.
The latest neuroscience shows that's wrong, giving rise to a whole new field of research called embodied cognition, which took off in the 80s. The ramifications of it are still transforming the way medical research is being conducted. To understand the full potential of VR, AR, and MR, we must have accurate mental models of how the brain and body interact. For that, we turn to the philosopher heroes on the half shell, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Their arch enemy, Krang. A disembodied, well, brain, who resided in the fishbowl belly of a hunky mecha body. I mean, while you're swapping out bodies, you might as well trade up to some abs, am I right?
You may feel some disorientation when you revive in your new body.
Krang's robotic body is a mute container, devoid of its own will or even facial expressions. Krang sometimes wandered about without his mecha.
You incompetent, staggering cretin! Help! My ganglion is stuck in some chewy gum!
Or popped into a more compact model when the situation demanded.
How very thoughtful!
Throughout it all, there was no change in Krang's sardonic personality. Didn't matter which body he was in. This follows Descartes' position that mind and body are separate, and the self/mind resides in the brain, and the brain alone. If it is indeed true that mind and body are separate, then our model of the brain giving the orders and the body merely following along, our VR experiences need only appeal to the brain. But that would be pretty boring. And the good news is, research shows that the arrow of causation runs in the other direction as well. The body performs an action and the brain follows along, changing state to best adapt to that situation. Let's explore further down the rabbit hole. Last week, I had the pleasure of being experimented on at David Byrne and Mala Gayankar's immersive theater experience, NeuroSociety. Participants take their places at podiums in a game show room. The host asks them age-old philosophical questions about the body and brain, and they have 3 seconds to answer each question. Okay, first question I'm going to pose to you. Imagine if you had your hands cut off and they were replaced with those of a criminal. Would you still be you?
Begin.
What's your answer? 80% of participants to NeuroSociety said yes, you are still you if you have your hands replaced. Next question. Imagine you're a head on a table being kept alive by various machines but lacking a body. Would you still be you? NeuroSociety participants dropped from 80% yes on the previous question to now only 45% saying a head on a table without a body is still the same self. Our culture is split nearly evenly on how much the body contributes to the self. We're not sure. Sci-fi authors have explored a future where technology allows us to leave part or all of our body behind. In Cory Doctorow's latest novel, Walkaway, a resourceful band of heretics and hackers scan the brain pattern, thoughts, and memories of people and run their consciousness as code on a server stack. Tiny spoiler alert. Initially, these disembodied beings spiral into existential crises and panic attacks so severe they crash their program. They suicide within minutes. Without a body, they lack the container to keep their emotions stable. I'm suggesting that reality is far stranger than that, that emotions are generated and felt in the body. Our perception of emotion is the mind observing the state of the body. It goes without saying that without eyes you can't see, but it turns out without a stomach, you can't have butterflies in your stomach. Without a gut, you can't have a gut feeling. It's not a metaphor, it's a description of the physical state your body is in during those emotions. It's so crazy, right?
Ooh, just because I'm all brain doesn't mean I don't have feelings.
Emotion is at the core of making VR content that is compelling, that a player wants to talk about to friends, and that they happily play multiple times. Let's look in on another room in the NeuroSociety experience. I walked into a pure white room with fancy Euro lounge chairs fitted with the VR headset on one of the arms. I met Britta, a tiny Swedish doll sitting on the same kind of fancy chair as me. I put on the headset and then I became Britta. Looking down, I saw her slash my tiny little feet. And by the way, I look terrible in green. Ah! No! Maybe you got a little bit of a squick watching this on the video, but the presence of VR means that things are way scarier than on a flat screen. I can tell you that in that moment, with the headset on, I had to close my eyes. It was so scary. So I felt it all the way down to my giblets. I hate scary movies. You're never going to catch me in a paranormal VR haunted house. Never.
What was that?
Never.
Ah!
Never. Can we talk about kittens and glitter and happy things for a minute, please? Neuroscientists aren't given to disembodying people, so they have to use more subtle means. In a study published by the Oxford University Press, researchers paralyzed a part of the body. Don't worry, it's a temporary paralysis. They paralyzed the frown muscles with Botox. Subjects were then asked to look at a photo of someone smiling or frowning. The brain scans showed lowered activity when they were trying to imitate the frowning face as compared to imitating the smiling face. Turns out, without the muscles in the face to mirror that frown that they were looking at, they had less going on in the region of the brain that processes emotion. Another example of how the brain changes state in response to the body is runners lacing up their trainers and going out for a nice long jog. In response to that motion and exertion, the brain releases endorphins, creating a pleasant emotional state known as a runner's high, which has been well studied and documented. And for a very extreme example, bad governments torture people by using stress positions to extract confessions, because you can't say, "Oh, I think I'll feel happy now," when your body is in a stress position. You feel what your body tells you to feel. The growing pile of evidence, which suggests that the brain and body exist in a constant feedback loop with each other, has wide-ranging implications. It means that neuroscientists, psychologists, and philosophers need to sit down and have a real long chat. For robotics, it has implications as well. Robotics researchers posit that true artificial intelligence will not arise until robots have sensory and motor skills and are connected to the world through a body. For those of us designing and developing in VR, it means that we can now interact with the entire body to create deeply satisfying and compelling experiences in a way that traditional gaming or film will never do. By asking your players to change their body position, movement, gesture, or facial expressions, you can induce targeted emotion. This is stunning. You getting this down? You, as the builder of the virtual world, choose what your player will feel.
You're in for a few surprises!
Films and game, they set the mood with story, music, and color, which we can use as well. But the body as a controller in VR gives us an entirely new palette from which to paint. I've merely sketched out the parameter and size of the work to be done in this video. In future episodes, I'll be documenting the ways in which to produce targeted emotional state to create fun, novel, emotionally compelling, and how possibly even profound experiences. We have barely explored the possibilities of where our virtual and augmented worlds will take us. This is only the beginning, my friends. I am thrilled to be going on this journey with you and look forward to hearing how you use some of these concepts in your work. I hope to feature your work on the show, so please leave a comment below or hit me up on Twitter at Crystal D. Beasley. Look in the show notes for links to the gesture episode and more related episodes, as well as a link to where you can pre-order a copy of Dr. O's book coming out in April. I'm Crystal Beasley.
Your precious crystal.
And this has been Embodied Reality.
Everything's okay, I'm just trying to whack my head. Everything's okay. I'm